I think this Wintergreen function shows how quasi particles adjust to the fluctuation to the variety of the prime. So it's completely terrible thing. So in general, it's impossible to solve. And I think that in the most general case, even numerics had not been tried. So the only possible thing is to use some numerics with some simplification. Well, so yeah, and in this book of theory of non-equilibrium superconductivity, you can see quite a lot, plenty of these formulas, and Nikolai loved them, and he was able to extract some useful information from them in various limiting cases. So, turning to the one-dimensional wires, it was recognized, finally, I think it was recognized in the work by Kramer and Watson and Tobin in 1978, that if you are very close to the superconducting transition temperature, it's possible to write down a sufficiently simple but rather non-trivial time-dependent Ginzburg-Landau equation. So this is a time-dependent Ginzburg-Landau equation. So this part, you can easily recognize this is just the derivative of the free energy. And a naive way is to say that the psi dot is proportional to the derivative of the free energy. But in real life, you see it's slightly more complicated. It contains some non-analytic factors here, which depend on the rate of inelastic relaxation. So you are very close to Tc, and there are some inelastic relaxations in the system. In this case, these are electron phonon relaxation. And usually the rate, 1 over tau phonon, is much smaller than the temperature. So this is a small parameter. But if there are some relaxation, then its presence allows you to write some effective equation in this form. So this equation was used by Nikolai in studying quasi-1D situation. So it is controlled by the parameter gamma, which is given by this ratio. So tau phi is the inelastic rate divided by delta of t, which is the Ginzburg-Landau order parameter, which vanishes close to the critical temperature. So of course, the window where this theory can be applied is very small, but then still gamma can be either small or large. So there is some parameter here. And it's very good to have such nice equations, because the only thing which is left is just the dynamics of the other parameter field. And the presence of inelastic relaxation is important here, since it means that if you're very close to Tc, the other parameter changes rather slowly, so that quasi-particles can relax to the thermal distribution function. And then you can integrate easily the quasi-particle component, and you end up only with the superconducting component.
This equation is exactly the Cauchy-Arzt equation.
No, it's slightly more complicated. If you see, there are several ways to derive this time-dependent Ginzburg-Landau in a controlled way. What you mentioned is the Gierkowski-Rosberg equation, which works in the gapless situation, when you don't have a gap. The point is that you should suppress the gap in order to be able to describe some local in time equation. And in this case, this effectively is done by this parameter gamma. Because if inelastic relaxation is faster than the value of the gap, then to some extent you are again in the gapless situation. So it's possible to derive this equation either in the Abrikosov-Gierkow gapless situation or in the presence of sufficiently strong inelastic relaxation. And this was used by Nikolai and his classes.
Yes. In this equation, psi can be bigger than gamma? Or psi is always smaller?
Well, psi is of the order of one, and look, gamma is the ratio of the inelastic rate to delta. Psi can be bigger than gamma. Yes.
Okay.
Yes, so there are several. Well, you can look here.
What is U?
Pardon?
Coefficient U.
U is the speed of sound. Speed of sound. Joe, just it's numerical factor of the order of 5, made of some zeta particles. Okay. So one more thing to tell here is that there is a concept of charge imbalance, which is described by this gauge invariant electric potential, which is given by the sum of the electric potential and the derivative of the phase of the order parameter, which can be understood as the difference between the chemical potential of the normal subsystem and the chemical potential of the superconducting subsystem. And in equilibrium, they equal to each other and the imbalance vanishes. And if you write an equation for the imbalance, here an important length scale appears. So this is the electric field relaxation rate, LE, which is given by this expression. So this is basically the xi, the dirty coherence length. And here is the Fonon relaxation rate. So we see that in the case when the relaxation is very, very slow, it means that Fonon time is large. So this electric field relaxation length is much larger than xi. This will be the main limit. Okay, so what was done by Nikolai? Consider the problem of the stability of the normal state. So suppose that there is an infinite conducting channel with a normal current flowing, and you ask, is it possible to create some nucleus of a superconducting state? And if you are restricted to an infinitesimally small nucleus on a linear regime, then it was shown by Rogoff and Kulig that it's impossible. That it means that any small superconducting fluctuations which appears would finally die out. By the analysis of what was studied, it also shown that indeed there is a critical current I2 which separates two regimes. Above I2, the normal state is absolutely stable with respect to any formations of superconductivity, while below it is metastable. It means that it's possible to make a finite size nucleus of a superconducting state somewhere in the wire, and then it will finally expand to the whole sample. So in this case, it is normal state is metastable, and that's why there is some resistive state here. And the barrier, of course, there is some barrier. So here the normal state is overcooled. So this is a first order phase transition. And this the critical current, this critical current I2, well, it is again, it can be expressed through the parent current with this coefficient gain. So for sufficiently weak inelastic relaxation, this I2 is much larger than the coherence line, because L is large. And what was done by Nikolai in collaboration with Yudov and Maslova, he showed that if you take not an infinite wire, but a finite wire with some normal boundary here, so the good contact with some normal terminal, then they showed that for the nucleus of a superconducting state, it's much easier to appear to nucleate close to the normal boundary. So they solved the linearized TDGL equation there and obtained that there is another instability current such that if you are below this instability current, then the normal state is absolutely unstable. It means that even a small nucleus which appears here would finally propagate and some superconductivity will appear. So the general situation is the following, that if the current is smaller than the instability one, then the amplitude of the superconducting nucleus would grow. And otherwise, if it is larger, if you are here, then it's metastable. It means that to make an expanding nucleus, it should have some sufficient non-zero amplitude. So this is the conclusion that nucleation goes very close to the NSM boundary. So the wire is the superconducting, this is normal boundary. Well, because the current is carried by normal excitations, and the current velocity of Cooper pairs here is small, and that's why it's a region where it's better to have some superconductivity. Well, so this was about the behavior of the instability line, and generally this instability current is of the order of the critical current. Well, then resistive state. So now we are here, and We see that here we have some electric field coexisting with superconductivity. And how it happens, if you have some electric field, then it accelerates your Cooper pairs, and it means that the phase of the order parameter is winding here faster than here, and this spiral should relax somehow, and this goes to the formation of the phase slip centers. And it was recognized in this work by Ivrev and Kopnin that you can, if you look at the wire at a given time, then there is a series of phase slip center where the order parameter goes to zero, and then this structure repeats itself in time. So if you look at the structure of the phase slip centers in the x and time domain, then you will see something like a vortex, the vortex lattice. So each phase slip center can be considered as a vortex, because here the order parameter goes to zero, it vanishes, and if you calculate the phase winding while you go across along the vortex in this xt plane, then you will see that it's exactly 2 pi. So this, the appearance of phase slip centers is analogous to the vortex, lattice, and there is a nice quantization rule here. If you calculate the flux through the unit cell, the area of the unit cell is CT naught times L, and this is the average electric field in the structure, then you will get the superconducting flux quantum. So once you know the parameters of the flux lattice, you know the average electric field of the voltage across the sample. And also what was done by Nikolai here looked at this time-dependent Ginzburg-Landau equation in the most interesting limit when the change in Bell's relaxation length is larger than the coherence length. And without any numerical solution, by analyzing this time-dependent equation, he managed to extract the structure of the phase slip center. So it is characterized by several parameters made of these two lengths. So the separation between them, so it's periodically continued here, the separation between the phase slip centers is determined by this LE, electric field relaxation rate, and it is given by this expression for, of course, for larger currents, the period of the structure in x direction gets smaller. And then the order parameter, so this is the order parameter, and almost everywhere it is constant, time independent, and only very close to the phase slip center it exhibits some time dependence. So at some point it actually goes to zero, and then it relaxes. And also for the current, and this is for the imbalance. So once the phase slip appears, there is a strong imbalance there, and then it relaxes somehow, and then it reappears once again. So he managed to extract the structure of the phase slip center. And what is important about this picture is that it appears that time dependence is to some extent weak. It happens only in a very small region of the phase slip center, and that's why it's possible to describe almost everything in terms of time-independent equations, and they managed to obtain the current voltage characteristics analytically in this region. Okay, so there is a review written by
yes.
Yes. Yeah. The current voltage characteristics is sensitive to the length of the wire. Yes. So there are several regimes. For a sufficiently short wire, you can see the appearance of the first phase slip center. You can see two of them and so on. And this is basically the picture which is shown here. Yeah. So you can hear here the first phase slip center comes, here another one and so on. So you can count them. And for sufficiently long wires, well, this is smeared and you have some.
But if you have even one slip center always, you should obtain the same situation.
Right. So here you have one slip.
Because you just increase the frequency of phase slip, that's all. Even for one, you can do the same.
Yeah.
So you obtain the same picture.
поднимет.
Why? You generate one step, one.
So this here the first facelift centric gears at this point.
Excuse me, what do you mean? No. Having one facelift center, is it stationary object?
No, it's not stationary, it's time dependent. It is you can think that it's standing in the center of the wire, but it's dynamical. So delta goes to zero through some periods. Just what is shown here, yeah? This is the center of the wire, so and here goes delta goes to zero.
Okay.
Yeah.
Periodically, you can change either the number of sleeping centers or the frequency of phase switches.
Yes, of course, yes.
And if you just fix only one sleeping center, you obtain the same picture, because if you increase current, you increase the frequency of phase switches. That's all.
Yes. But they had the equation, right? Time-dependent Ginzburg equation. You can solve this equation, and you see that the distance between the facelift center is sensitive to the current. If you increase the current, then the distance between the facelift center decreases, which is a result of calculation.
Wow.
Yeah. Of course, well, that's a problem, that without good equations, it's very difficult to describe a situation. What you said is correct, some from general ground, but if you look at the equations, that you see that they come close to each other for sufficiently large currents. Well, there were a lot of works on this facelift center, tons of works. But I think this was the first analytical understanding of the structure. That's why it's important, given some estimates on all the relevant scales.
You say something like having many vortices instead of multiple contacts.
Yeah, yeah.
What?
Yes.
Vladimir is telling that you might have more frequency which would correspond to have multiple contact vortices, but it's better to split.
Yeah, but we know that usually it's better to split into several. Okay, so there is a review on these issues, which was published in UFN and then in Advanced Physics. Yes, there was another observation. And now, in the rest of my talk, I briefly describe what's going on in a similar situations. So this is the work where they looked at NS junction of finite width, and then the finite voltage was applied. And I think that the main difference is that now people work well below the critical temperature. So no Ginzburg-Landau, any time dependence cannot be applied. So very, very low temperatures, and they look at the superconductivity, the current voltage characteristic, and I will particularly be interested in the behavior of this point. So this is the normal state, and it becomes unstable below some critical current, and then some traces of superconductivity. So this is the upward, and this is downward. And if you look carefully there, in this experiment, there was a tunneling probe here, which was used to measure the density of states in the wire. And if we are moving from the superconduction side, we are on this branch, that we see that, well, it's basically the typical BCS density of state here. So just we are in a situation which is very close to superconductivity. But if we move from that direction, we see that, and we measure the density of states here, we see that some gradually, so this is the normal state, and some superconductivity, some traces of superconductivity gradually appear here. So how to describe this? We consider a wire between two normal terminals in the limit of sufficiently long wire, so that this length is much larger than the zero temperature coherence length, or put differently, the critical temperature is much larger than the thoroughless energy of the system. In this setup, it's possible to... So we're interested in the stability of the normal state, and this crucially depends on the distribution function in the normal state, which for sufficiently
short wire and for sufficiently low temperature cannot be non-thermal. So in general, in order to find the distribution function, we have some kinetic equation with collision integrals for electron-electron, electron-phonon. And well, there are several limiting cases. So the first is the elastic case when you don't have any interaction, and then can be electron-phonon or electron-electron dominant case. So this is the distribution function. Well, in a sense, that the thermal distribution is tangent, changes from minus 1 to 1. So we have three cases. This is a two-step. So this is the left part of the junction, the right part. So it interpolates between left and right. So this is the case of strong electron-phonon interaction. It's locally thermal with a linearly changing electric potential. And if you have strong electron-electron interaction, then the local temperature is different at different points of the wire. So we look at the linearized time-dependent Ginzburg-Landau equation. But on top of this exact non-necessarily thermal distribution function in the normal state. And there are two regimes. First is the regime of sufficiently weak non-equilibrium when everything is universal is, and is independent on the particular relaxation mechanism. And for higher voltages, everything is sensitive to the distribution function. And if you look at the linearized equation, and after some algebra, you arrive at an effective Hamiltonian, quantum mechanical Hamiltonian defined on a segment from minus 1/2 to 1/2. It's just a quantum mechanical motion in the field of an imaginary and constant electric field controlled by this letter V. Well, the Hamiltonian is non-remission. Therefore, generally one should expect that the spectrum is also non-remission. It's complex. Yeah. But in fact, it's slightly more complicated because this is an example of non-remission Hamiltonian of PT symmetry. If you change x to minus x and apply complex conjugation, it will go into itself. So this symmetry restricts that this spectrum, for any eigenvalue, there is a complex conjugate eigenvalue. And this symmetry protects the spectrum for sufficiently small v. So if v is very small, well, so these are the first two excited eigenfunctions, more absolute value of them. So for zero, v is just a square box. We know that the spectrum is convex, 1, 4, and so on. But then, if we increase v further, then the spectrum remains real. And if we are somewhere here, then the absolute value of these two eigenfunctions are coming close to each other. And then there is a point here when they become equal, and then there is a bifurcation. At this point, the real two real lambdas coincide, and then after then they are allowed to go to the complex plane, complex plane, acquire some complex plane. So there is a bifurcation at in physical notations when the EV is of the order of 50,000 energy, and it means that if the bias is sufficiently small, then the superconducting state which wants to nucleate is more or less well uniform. But if voltage is larger than this bifurcation threshold, then there are two superconducting states which want to nucleate close to the boundary. That's what was observed by Ivlev and Kapin in case of infinite wire. So this is the instability line as a function of temperature. You're very close to TC, so this is the stationary symmetric state, and here is the non-stationary bimodal distribution, and it was obtained previously some not very clear numeric calculation by Vodolazov and also in this work by Kirkhoff. And then if we go even for larger voltages, then we see that the state will be very close to the boundary. Here we exactly reproduce the result of Ivlev and Kapin, provided that the leading mechanism of relaxation is electron-phonon.
But then, as I said, everything is strongly sensitive to the mechanism of electron-electron-relaxation. So for when the dominant is electron-electron, you have a different dependence here. And in the case when you don't have any interaction, actually it goes to exponentially large voltages. So this is the behavior of the stability line. And what is important is that since everything is strongly sensitive to the relaxation mechanism, one can look at the situation differently, so that by studying the instability line, the temperature dependent of the instability line, you can get access to the particular inelastic mechanism in the wire. So it can be used as a probe.
Yes.
So, well, I think I stop here. So from this part of the talk, we see that at sufficiently large bias is superconductivity nucleus close to the terminals, as was obtained by Ivlev and Kampun long ago. And what is interesting now, if we go to low temperatures and short scales, that this instability line is sensitive to the distribution function in the normal state, which in turn is sensitive to the relaxation mechanism. And by measuring instability line, you can get some access to the mechanism of inelastic relaxation in the normal state. Thank you.
Okay. Questions, comments, remarks? Sorry.
The first conclusion when you say superfluidly nucleates and is non-stationary, you mean after nucleation it remains non-stationary?
Thank you. It's a good question. Look, if so the left and the right have different voltages, different chemical potential. So if this guy nucleates in this way, so let's here, minus V over 2 here is plus V over 2. So in this gauge, this guy is time independent, doesn't rotate. It just fills the average chemical potential of the left and of the right. In this case, you have two nuclei, so this guy is close to the left terminal, so it rotates. Its phase is rotating with some frequency close to minus V2. And this guy rotates with the frequency plus V2. So there are two new nucleus, each close to each old terminal. And then it means they rotate with different phases. And it means that there is a flowing Josephson current between them. So it's a non-stationary situation.
Just phase shift, in fact.
In fact, it can be considered as if you have a phase slip. Yeah. Some truncated, but right, phase slip.
Okay. So, more questions? Okay, let us. Thank you. So, now there is substitution, and now there will be the talk of Ivan Haimovich. So, please.